Thank you very much, Dr. Sen. Good afternoon, friends. I will be moderating this afternoon's session. But may I just take about 3 or 4 minutes to say something about the historical context in which the document that we will be discussing this afternoon was drafted. Because we are all participants of that historical process that occurred 32 years ago. Once the last piece of basura was cleaned up from EDSA 32 years ago, during what was called the People Power Uprising, the hard work of the building, preparing, reconstructing, and restoring our broken legal, political, and economic systems had to take place. In earnest, the new government that was headed by Cory Aquino, which was formed in the wake of the EDSA uprising, was racing against time. Racing because the transition from the Marcos dictatorship to the Cory Aquino government could be aborted anytime, it could be hijacked or derailed anytime by various forces from the left or the right, from the civilian and the military. It could happen anytime. Cory, in effect, was forced to declare what amounts to a revolutionary government, a red ball, although it wasn't called that, under a freedom, a so-called freedom constitution, that gave President Aquino almost absolute powers to do anything, because there was no Congress. And she said she would stay as president under a freedom constitution until a new legislature and a new set of public officials could be properly elected by the people under a duly ratified new constitution. So, really racing against time. And the elections could not be held without a new constitution. That is the reason why, I mean, you have to understand there was an existing constitution, which we call the Marcos Constitution of 1973, which we all thought was not properly ratified by the people. Cory could have ruled under the 1973 constitution, but it was really just not possible because it would have meant recognizing a record of the existing Batas and Papansan. It would have meant recognizing the existing Supreme Court as it was duly constituted. It would have meant respecting all the local government officials who had served under Marcos. And various other things. So there was no alternative but to throw away the 1973 Constitution, invoking the authority and the powers of the new government, which took its legitimacy not from the elections of February 1986, but rather from the legitimacy of the People Power Uprising on EDSA. And so, in this context, was the Constitutional Commission conceived. 48 wise men and women, including Popper, as we have this afternoon, were appointed by Mrs. Aquino, chosen and picked from various sectors and from various disciplines of our country in order to craft a new basic charter for our country. And the task was to design a legal document, a basic charter, that would embody the highest ideals and aspirations of the Filipino people in the way of what has just happened, meaning the People Power Revolution. One can view the 1987 Constitution as an attempt to preempt the return to the status quo political system. Status quo ante, because there was that tendency politically for the traditional politicians to take over the process and really hijack the entire revolutionary process that began in Edis. So, mapapansin, dun sa composition ng 1986 Constitutional Commission, halos walang politiko. They were excluded, actually. Magalit lang in many ways. No? There were very few politicians like Blas Ortopla, who's not necessarily a traditional politician, and Sensing Suarez of Pampanga, who is also an unconventional political figure, but none from the traditional political mode. No? So, kumbaga, ang 1986 Constitutional Commission, 48 ang mga tao, hindi ko talaga respetadong intellectual and cultural leaders of our country. The product of their work, which I think encompassed about, how many months? 6 months? Yeah. Just 4 months. June to October. Was a very detailed, sometimes wordy document, overly detailed document from the poet, the original. But now I begin to understand why it was so detailed and so thick. The reason for that, looking back, no, and correct me if I'm wrong, as an observer of the work that you did, it was precisely to preempt whatever initiative the politicians might take after. Kaya talagang napaka-detalyado, no? Leaving little room for, almost no room for legislative tinkering after the ratification of the Constitution. No? Kaya halos wala yung, as may be provided by the phrase, which would have meant it was space now. Now, let me say this, no? As an observer, the 1987 Constitution's principal features were, number one, to my mind, legally, methodically worked out document regarding emergency powers of the president, basically functional, to prevent the abuse of such powers precisely by a future tyrant. Number two, a clear delineation of the functions of the main branches of government under the separation of powers principle, including the guarantee of autonomy for the constitutional commissions, including the ombudsman. A strong Bill of Rights, a strong social justice part aimed precisely at empowering the poor and the marginalized, who hitherto, under a so-called democracy, had really been excluded from the rights of citizenship. The institutionalization of the role of people's power, of people's organizations, you know, culminating in the recognition of an alternative way of electing a number of our legislators through the partisan representation system. Subsequently, it was abused beyond recognition. So looking back, how many, I don't know how many of us in the room today have read the Constitution, the 1987 Constitution, from beginning to end, and compare it with the previous Constitution, 1973 or 1935, or the Malolos Constitution. Probably, I would suspect, very few of us have really read it from beginning to end, and if we have read it, if it was required reading all the more, we probably did not make any effort to understand it. But I mean, look at it this way. The basic foundation of active citizenship in any polity is the Constitution. If you don't understand it, you don't read it, you don't appreciate it, how can you participate actively in the life of the polity? I think this is the reason why, here I will end, when Hugo Chavez became president of Venezuela, the first thing that he did was to print millions and millions of copies pocket copies of the new Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela constitution and distributed these among the citizens of Venezuela, requiring them to read it wherever they were, while waiting for the LRT or the MRT, during the breakdown of the old MRT, while waiting for the buses, and so on and so forth. It was just required reading, they put it at their back pockets. I wish that there would come a time when our people begin on their own to take the initiative to read the Constitution in the language to which they understand it. But now, 32 years later, you know, mukhang patotokal na itong Constitution na ito, no? Before it finally becomes the victim of BJP, let us try to understand what is in it. Before it is too late, it is too late by listening precisely to four of the distinguished individuals, Filipinos, who helped decide it. It's a very, very interesting constitution. I'm not exaggerating. It is not to say it's a perfect constitution, but it is a very well designed, very well conceived constitution. Now, first to do that they call on the Blue Angel Gray, one of the few women participated. A maximum of six women. Yeah, except that the president of the Constitutional Commission, Justice Cecilia Muñoz Ramon, was a woman, and I remember all the other women. They were all very strong women, very assertive, and one of them was precisely Dr. Flor Angel Gray. If you read anything, you come across the 1987 Constitution that has any reference to cooperatives and to mass communications, we owe those provisions to the activeness of Dr. Gray. So, Clark?